Good evening, everyone. A very warm welcome to the first speaker series from your SEAL Council. It's indeed my great pleasure and honor to introduce this wonderful gentleman who comes from a very, very humble background and made it big in life. A scientist by education who started his career from a PSU general insurance company to become the MD and CEO of Bajaj Allianz General Insurance, the most admired company in the industry. He has won numerous accolades, to name a few: CEO of the Year at the 5th Annual Insurance Summit 2020, Personality of the Year in 2019. He has also been featured as LinkedIn top voice in India consecutively for the past 2 years, and he has about 6 lakh plus followers on social media. Customer obsession and passion to do good for people are what drives him and his success in the industry. He has made it a habit of being an industry first at initiatives that keep taking the insurance industry forward. His belief is to live in the moment and cherish it. For me personally, he is a leader, a visioner, a guru, and a friend. You'll be glad to know that he was my first boss when I started my career in 2001 and have shared a fantastic relationship since then. When I got this assignment to lead the corporate engagement for our cohort at ISB, I just couldn't think of any better speaker to start this series. I'm sure you all will agree to me when he starts speaking. Can we all have a big round of applause for Mr. Tapan Singhel, MD and CEO, Bajaj Allianz General Insurance Company Limited.
Thank you, Samir, and round of applause for all of you also. I think, I'm very honored and privileged to be speaking to some of the brilliant minds in the business currently. Samir has given me a small background about all of you, and that is why it's really impressive that I would get this chance to speak to you. Okay, so first I'll just
you're not audible, sir. You're on mute. I think you're on mute.
Yes, thank you, host. And who's trying to mute everybody, muted me also. So that is leadership at times. At times, we take a decision which is there. So I was trying to tell you that if I look at this company, which we started in the year 2001, I'm lucky to be the founding employee of this company. As I mentioned to you, people like Samir, who were there initially with us that time. So we built this company organically. And today, in about 19 years' time, if you look at, we have close to about 10 crore customers. And we are not listed as such, but if you would be listed, you'd be one of the most valued insurance companies in India. For a simple reason, because consistently in the market, not only we capture market share, but the beauty is we do so with a profit margin, which is disproportionate. So if I look at my market share in insurance in India, I'll be close to about 8% in the top line, but my profit market share would vary from 40% to 70% every year. So you have heard the story about, either you grow top line or profit, but as a company, I think consistently quarter on quarter, what we have been doing is we're not only capturing market share over time, but we also have a disproportionate share of the profit pool of the industry. And the times in the industry when I think it's about 300% of the industry's profit we have been able to make in a year wise. So that is why, and the kind of customer acquisition that we do, which runs into crores, as I told you, we already have close to 10 crore customers. And any innovation that you see in the insurance industry has been done, predominantly, I can say with a lot of pride, would be by Bajaj Insurance Company. Now, all this sounds very impressive, but let me tell you the background story and the fun behind it, so that you actually enjoy that when we talk of innovation, try to take credit of it, how desperation got us to get this innovation done. So those stories will interest you. One, I'll speak about that. But second, before I start on that, let me speak a bit of the industry and the beauty of this industry. And how do you perceive it? And let me throw some challenges and questions to you, And then let's see, how do we solve this and how does innovation evolve? And how does an industry, we're able to make disproportionate profit and also capture market share in a cutthroat environment, which is there, The second I speak to you. And third, Samir wants to speak, me to speak about something about my personal career. We'll see if you have time on that or some specific questions you have, we'll be happy to take that and speak about it. So let me speak about the industry first. Let me throw an interesting challenge to you. If you look at the general insurance industry in India, and it's more or less across the world also, but India specifically, for about over a decade now, the combined ratio, I'll explain to you what the combined ratio has been close to 115 to 120%, which technically means that every 100 rupees that the insurance industry takes, the outgo is about 115 to 120%. No, let's, if I just put it simply like that, which means every 100 rupees, 15 to 20 rupees is a loss. About 7 to 8% maybe investment returns also, but minus that also, the industry will be bleeding. Now, how does the industry bleed? Simply because the industry pays claims, expenses, and commission, three outgoes. Majority is claims, which means the insurance industry is paying claims through the nose, because with a combined ratio of 115 to 120%, 15% over 100, that is there. Unbelievable. Such a huge industry, a massive customer base, massive distribution. And for over 10 years now, I think 2007, so not 10, it's about 13 years, the industry has been in this situation. No, 13 years, the industry has 20% off. And if you look at Amazon, which speaks as a very customer-centric organization, the loss over 100 is about 6% only. You know, so at a 6% loss, people say they are very customer-centric. At a 20% loss, if I ask you your impression of insurance industry, you would say these guys don't pay claims. This is now the problem statement. It's an interesting statement, huh? For 13 years in India, the industry is bleeding to death. No, quite a few companies are for sale. If you have money, buy them. No, and they can't sustain. Shareholders are giving up. Some are like us, doing a different story, but most, you know, are in deep problem. And when you talk to the person at large, they tell you the industry does not pay claims. Is it not ironical? Data says something else, and perception something else. Okay, let me park this no problem state. I don't want to give you answers right now, because that will help you think how you do innovation, how do you solve industry problems. So I park one of this problem here. Let me give a second problem, and then answer no the way I think. No, as Samir mentioned, I'm a scientist by education, so for me everything has to be solved. No, from or you keep on working on it till it is solved. The second problem statement is, let's look at insurance cover. Let's look at COVID. Now, COVID can happen to anyone, right? It is not that COVID will spare XYZ. No, it is a pandemic. Anybody can get COVID. The average cost for COVID treatment is about 1.5 to 2 lakh rupees. Fair point. Now, if I look at the health insurance in India, 40 crore, which is below poverty line or at poverty line, is covered by government health scheme, no? Which is the Prime Minister health scheme, which is there. The insurance industry will be covering about 11 crore people. So let's say if I take the Indian population at 130 crores, what we are talking about is that about give and take 55 crore people would be covered by health. So 130 minus 55 would be what? 75 crores people are uninsured. In the 75 crore, we already removed the BPL because they are covered by government. It's 40 crores gone. So we're not talking of BPL or below poverty lines. Now you'd be surprised and happy to know that all insurance companies have a Corona product, you know, and it's available on their website and it's with the distribution. The cost of that product would be about less than 3 rupees a day, you know, for a claim up to a sum insured, it's about 2 lakh rupees. Okay. And underwriting means the acceptance part of our policy is single click, because there's no underwriting restriction. You just have a 15-day waiting period. You buy a Corona product, wait for 15 days and the product is on. And if you catch COVID up to 2 lakh rupees, it is paid. Obviously you have much higher sum insured also. I'm talking about the base Corona product is available on all websites at a cost of less than 3 rupees a day. 75 crores uninsured, ease of purchase, single click, all website of insurance companies, anybody can get COVID, high level of awareness. So technically, what should be happening? The insurance company's server should be crashing. No? Because 75 crores logging into, let's say, 40 insurance companies to buy the product or trying to reach to distribution, because it can happen to any one of us, and the cost is less than 3 rupees a day. But did it happen? In the month of April, the health insurance for the industry was minus 3% growth. Okay, a phenomenal problem statement, yeah? You have an illness which can happen to anybody. Average cost of it will be 1.5 to 2 lakh rupees. You have an insurance product available at less than 3 rupees a day. You have 75 crores uninsured Indians from health insurance perspective. And you have no hassle of the process of buying this policy. Single click and no underwriting. 15 days from now, you get a cover. But servers are not crashing. Why is it so? Okay. Park the second problem. I'll answer the first and come to the second one. No. And in your mind, you think, like, why should it be so? Now, let me go to the first problem statement. Industry bleeding to death paying claims, and public at last says, ye bima company le claim nahi dete, khali paisa lena aata inko, no? That's a popular no perception. Okay. Now, let's understand the industry. 16th century, insurance industry got opened up. What does an insurance company or industry do? Take money from many to pay to a few who have an untoward incident for which they are covered. Simple. So insurance companies are the custodian of public money. So all of us pay money to the insurance company. Here's my money. If things go wrong for me, as per our contract, please pay me the money. Fair enough. But also ensure that you don't waste my money paying to fraudsters. Don't waste my money throwing it away for people who just come to take a claim without verifying it's part of the contract or not. Because it's my money that you're going to spend. No, so be careful. You are custodian of public money. Fair enough. Good. So what does the insurance company do? The moment somebody lodges a claim, they have to eliminate fraud. So a claimant would be seen with the lens that is he or she a fraudster. They'll eliminate all frauds. Once all frauds are eliminated, they pay. That is the process, no? Fair process, because custodian of public money, you just can't keep. Anybody lodges a claim, you pay money. Anybody lodges a claim, pay money. Then they'll be out of, no? And it's our money that they'll be distributing like, no, charity. But that is not what we had paid money to insurance companies for. It was to pay for a specific incident for which, no, the contract was there. And they just can't be doing that. Otherwise, we'll sue them. So the insurance industry would settle a claim by eliminating all fraud elements, looking at the contract and paying it. That is the process, which I think is the right process to do. Good. Now let's come on customer side. As a customer, I have paid the money. I have a genuine loss. I go to the insurance industry. I lodge a claim. Now they start doubting all my intentions, no? And they start asking me all random questions, no? Radu, kitne mein gaadi chala rahe the? Daru piye the, nahi piye the? Kahan se aa rahe the? How does it matter, bhai? I have lost a claim. My guy, ladki, pay me the claim. As simple as that. What the hell are you asking me these questions for? So my experience is terrible. I feel that the insurance industry doesn't want to pay claims. That is why they're doing all this funny stuff. No, they're thugs of the first order. Now, a customer perspective is right. The insurance company perspective is also right. No, because they're all doing their own job. How do you solve it? How do you solve this problem? And this is not India. The insurance company perspective is like this across the world. No, and let me tell you a funny story before I come to solving this problem. When I started this JV between Bajaj and Allianz in the year 2001, I remember I was sitting with some of my Allianz colleagues, German, and I was telling them, in India, joint insurance industry is considered like you're good for nothing. Yeah, and he was laughing. He said, no, in Germany is better. See, when you're good for nothing, you become a bartender. And when you fail the bartender, you join an insurance company. Yeah? So. So this perception I'm talking about insurance industry is across the world, it's not about India. Okay. Now to solve it, this was fine in the 16th century when you had to send somebody, a surveyor, to look at stuff, ask questions. But in today's time, with tech, with immense amount of data, immense amount of plug-in happening, immense amount of credit scoring happening, why would you not use all that and settle claims in a very similar experience for the customer? Now, let me give you an example. Something I did, it was world first when I did it. Now, most companies do it. I think Samir in Toyota has led it very aggressively in the front. So now if I look at it, if let's take an automobile, it's an easier example to take. An automobile meets an accident. So earlier, obviously, you don't have cameras with you when you're traveling, but now every phone is a camera. You get down, click pictures, upload. Now, from an insurance company perspective, I already have immense data. No, we are settling like crores of claims in automobile. No, so I have immense of data in my computer. As you upload with the matching of data, I can figure out within minutes what is the claim for such accident in the past that I have paid. No, and then I make an offer to you, and actually within 10 minutes time, I can transfer money to your bank account. Now this looks interesting, no? Because an accident happens on the street, you just park the consultant site, click pictures, upload, money is with you. Now you go to wherever you want to go for negotiation, dealership, repair it. And the way Sami does it in Toyota is, you go to the dealership, you have video recording, gets uploaded, immediate settlement of claims, done, immense. Now, this looks like, okay, what's so great about it? But let me take you 20 years back. In the year 2000, if you had a motor claim, and I do not know if any one of you would be here who would have had a claim in the year 2000, the process was you go to insurance company, intimate, you had to go to intimate. Then they would deputy a first surveyor would come look at it. It's called pre-inspection. Then when your vehicle is getting repaired, your second surveyor would come, click pictures of each part of the repair, and they had to wait for every part of the repair that pictures would click. After completion, a third surveyor would come to take a picture of the complete vehicle. Then you as an insured had to collect all the salvage parts, take it to the insurance company's branch office, and there the insurance company would take out the picture and look from the picture and the salvage, tally it together before they approved the claim. And if you got your money in 3 months' time, you were extremely happy. Today, by the click and 10 minutes time, no question asked, claim is paid to you. We did mobile insurance among the first, and Flipkart was and is our distributor for this. And we insured like 100,000 of mobile in one day across the country. And all damages, we could remote assess and pay that. Frauds eliminated by using data that we have for our tools, which is there. So fundamentally, when you make the claim process as simple, in spite of how complicated it is, using tech, data, and all the background that you have, and the customer has a very similar experience, this perception, insurance industry don't want to pay claims, changes. And when that changes, then the industry actually comes to the light again. So this, I think, is something that, and this is what we thought about. So one of our ambitions in the company is that can all claims be settled in 10 minutes time, all retail claims. And for commercial and corporate claims, we want to settle 70-80% in 24 hours time of the loss. And we made this move, and I talk about it in a lot of forums because that I feel would change the perception of the insurance industry across the world for no fault of theirs. Now the second point, Corona product, why is the servers not crashing? Why all of us don't have the product if it is so conveniently available? So I asked a psychologist friend of mine, and he said, simply because our human brain is not wired to see risks. Because if it was wired to see a risk, we don't left the caves. We still be staying in caves and not venturing out at all. And I can also give you some more example. And when we were younger, the speed at which we drove two-wheelers, and the speed at which we drive today, you would see the difference yourself. Like as you age, you understand the risk better, compared to when you were younger. The way the rules you would break when you were young to the rules you would break now is different. The human brain is not wired to see risks, So insurance gets purchased when a conversation happens. So let's say I start talking to you guys about conversation, about why Corona is critical for you, why you should not have a product and it doesn't cost you much. I promise you, most of you will buy the product. Insurance is a conversational sale. And that is why when you talk of de-intimidation, a lot of businesses, insurance across the world, even the insurtechs which came up on a direct-to-customer basis, they could not become great success. They embedded policies in different products. So let's say if I embedded a mobile insurance in mobile cover. But as a direct-to-customer sale, pure insurance product, I've yet to see companies do that. So they struggle with this fact. The fundamental issue is, can we get conversations online? This is where the missing link is, and that's what people miss. Now, can this happen? Why not? When I was in, I remember, in Amazon office in US, they told me that Alexa has more marriage proposals than a single lady would be getting. If I look at, let's say, Siri or an Oko Google, the kind of conversation, ask them tell a joke or ask them anything they are able to answer. So a human being has started associating with Alexa as a real person, as a Siri, as a real person, the better they get. So conversations can happen digitally. Transformation in insurance industry would be if they can take digital conversations on and then they try direct to customers. So a lot of insured techs across the world thought so easy, we'll break this legacy insurance companies, we shall be able to sell online, we'll bring our cheapest product, direct to customers, and they all bombed. The only success story was when they embedded the policy. Why? They forgot this perspective that insurance is a conversational sale. But does it mean that we can't have direct to customers? Yes, we can. Where is the conversation? If Alexa,
and then
okay, Google can do it. How do you link it up now? So there's two problems, but we don't have much time. Let me tell you about what all impact insurance industry has on the country. Do you or can you believe that the average life expectancy of Indians has moved up by 5 years because of insurance? Bold statement. Huh? Let me try and explain to you. Okay. And since I was really pushing this very aggressively, and I'll also tell you what is the next thing I'm pushing, which makes a difference to huge number of Indians across, and why as an Indian I've been in this position a long time, even though I could have gone to Asia to head Asia or be a global head, no, but I prefer to stay in India. This will answer that question. Now let's look at it. When we had the national health scheme come through and 40 crores Indian got covered, the sum insured at that level is for a 5 lakh floater, a 5 lakh cover in the hands of the person. The moment the purchasing power goes to 5 lakh rupees in the remotest corner of the country and the poorest person in the country, suddenly, after the announcement, if you do an analysis and look at all the health investments which has come through, be it in terms of health startups, be it in terms of hospital moving to tier 2, tier 3, be in terms of clinics being open, be in terms of more doctor requirement coming in. Just study, after the National Health Scheme got launched, a plethora of investments started happening. Why? With the purchasing power, which was not there, has come now. No? Suddenly, things which are not viable are becoming viable. So, why is it that Japan has a 90-year plus expectancy of life and Uganda has 40-year plus? The difference is healthcare. Just by insuring 40 crore people, the average expectancy of Indians move up by 5 years. Now, let me give you another example, what we are working on next. You see all these floods and storms happening all across the country, no? For us, most of us know we are comfortable, we have beautiful houses and doesn't affect as much as 2 days of power outage or something. But imagine a man at 60 has built a small home in one of these areas, has a container in his house, and one evening all this gets washed away, which means his 20, 30 years of hard work and savings has got washed away. How does he build up his home again? How does he build the content again? Where does he go? Today, India has more moved towards a nuclear family setup. The joint family structure of safety net is gone. An old couple, where do they go next? So what we have offered to the government, and I saw the Nagaland government has taken that, Kayla is talking about it, is that if a rainfall exceeds a certain amount of level, or let's say a cyclone of a certain wind speed comes, or an earthquake happens to a certain level, we shall transfer X amount of money to all individuals, to the general. You have money in your bank accounts, which means the rebuilding starts, which means the economic growth starts happening again. Are you aware that when a cyclone comes, actually the economic condition of that place improves? No, it's a study in the US which always shows why, because a lot of rebuilding starts happening, a lot of investments of money starts coming through. Srinagar, I'll give you an example. I have a 50% market share in Jammu and Kashmir, which means every second insured in that state is insured by Brazilians. 2014, we had floods there. No, Srinagar floods, 14, 18 feet of water. I personally went there. We paid 1200 crore rupees in 3 months' time and door to door. Well, the government till date have paid about 300, 400 crores. Do we realize the amount of money that the insurance company pumps in when things go wrong? The way it helps in nation rebuilding is phenomenal. So if a day when you read this in the newspaper and you see this parametric insurance I'm talking about, and all governments are taking about it, a central government is central about it, will improve the life conditions of majority of Indians. Have you ever realized the insurance companies play such a powerful role in nation building? Have you realized that most of the investment, which is a tune of 3 lakh crore of money, is actually put by insurance companies in all these government bonds, investment bonds? 3 lakh crore we contribute, which is used by government for building, you know, all these roads. I'm not talking about the claims. I'm talking of our investment money, the cash that we provide. Have you ever seen that whenever government requires bailout, who goes for bailout? When IDBI required bailout, who paid for the money? LIC. Have you ever realized that the biggest employer in India is insurance industry? We employ close to 40 lakh people. Phenomenal kind of contribution to nation, to changing, no, the fortune of nations, to building out that kind of, no, a phenomenal difference. As an insurance professional, I think I'm obsessed about this, and a lot of times I say we get paid to do good. But have you ever thought it like this? The innovation, the structure, the country contribution, the building it, the manpower employment, the employment generation, no? Changing the average life expectancy of Indians or bringing on no difference to lifestyle. And let me end for each one of you. It also ensures a life of pride. Let me give you an example of how it works. So let's say if I look at and do this for me, go to any hospital. Most of you would be visiting hospitals for some reason or the other, or to meet somebody. Stand at the billing counter and watch this very closely. I've done this many times when people do not believe. No, so I actually go and stand, take them to the hospital and make them stand to the billing counter. So when you look at the billing counter, you'll find suddenly there's an old man who comes in and children are with him. He has to be admitted and the hospital asks for X amount of money to deposit it. No, the children are looking at each other, who will pay that money? Imagine the old man all his life. No, maybe he did not have enough food, slept hungry for his children, and the money has to be paid. They're looking at each other. Or the people who don't have money, they sell jewelry, land, no? 70% people pay out of pocket in hospitals. And if you have people of insurance, you see, just walk in, get the best treatment, best doctors, best hospitals. It makes such a huge difference to individual lives also. So it's a phenomenal industry to be in. I wanted to be a scientist, ended up being an insurer. But if I go back in the time and ask myself, what will I want to be? I would say I want to be a scientist. So that's a different story altogether. How much time I've taken? 30 minutes. Okay, good. So that was something which I want to speak to you about. I think I'll take question answers much better, no, than to keep a one-sided conversation on that. I thought I'll give you some perspective. Over to you guys.
Thank you, Tapan. I think that was really useful. So we have got quite a lot of questions and I'll like to ask those questions one by one. And then people whose question I'm asking, you can unmute and put a follow-up question if you think you need to ask something else as well. Okay, so this question which has come from Lakshmipati, he says that we normally don't get advisors who are selling their insurance products to the customers. They don't generally provide solutions for the customer's needs. They are more into selling their own product and which pays the advisor more money or more commission. So how do you manage this or what is your thought on this?
Very good. So Lakshmi, wherever you unmute yourself, we'll have a conversation. So let me
actually ask you about this. Yes, Tapan, I'm there.
Yeah, good. Good to be here. Now, what you said is right. Now, but let me ask you a few questions. So when you buy a car, do you do some research?
Yes, of course, I do.
When you buy some, let's say, fancy perfume, do you do some research?
Yes, I do.
For everything that you buy, Lakshmi, do some research. When you buy insurance, this one individual comes to whatever tells you, sign on a blank form and give it to him, you know. And then tomorrow you feel that you don't get the right product. It's all available, but you just go to insurance company, any site, and you have no huge amount of data information about what you require, what you want. Since it's a conversational sale, no, that is where the issue comes in. You have to have a conversation. The person who has a conversation with you, you have faith on him. But not all intermediaries, but majority would. He or she would want to sell in which he or she makes the most money. Good intermediaries don't do that, no? So let me tell you, and most of you or some of you would be salespeople. Good salespeople do what is good for customers. Then they are able to sell for a longer time, no? And those kind of advisors also exist, and they really do very good. No, they give you the best, whatever is the best for you, and they will offer you something, no, which is actually good for you, not necessarily be the best for them at times. So we have a huge amount of people who like this. Some would be, will try to sell you what they feel is good for them. So when you are researching for everything that you buy, my humble request is, if you spend about 20 minutes time, you'll have enough information to decide what you want to buy.
No? Okay, let me reframe my question a little bit, or probably add on to it. I mean, there's something called elephant theory. You know, there is a small chain to the big elephant tied to one of the legs. And the elephant always thinks that, you know, it is smaller and it can't untie it because it was programmed or conditioned when the baby elephant was tied to a chain. Yes. And the elephant always thinks. So we have an elephant called LIC. So LIC has conditioned the way the market is expected to operate. So there was no conversations. It was more on relationship-based business they've done for years together. So as customers, we were all conditioned in such a way that, you know, an insurance person coming to me and having a conversation to me is all about trying to sell a solution what suits him or her. So I'm just, my question is, how did Bajaj Alliance manage to overcome this elephant theory and then making a successful business out of it?
Two things we did, like a very good question. First and foremost, insurance has two parts. One is LIC, which sells life. Another is non-life, which is GIC, you know, which are New India Oriental National United. A lot of companies, about 40 of them, no, which sells anything except natural death. So let's say automobile to everything. One thing that we did very early on is we did not take the existing agents. We built our own agency the way we wanted them to be built. No, we taught them to be obsessed about the customers and give him or her what is right for him or her, because that will pay them in the long run. Because we taught a new breed of agents, we created new distribution, and distribution also became very powerful. No, we created the OEM distribution. You'll be happy to know that when you go to an OEM today and buy vehicles, Bajaj was the first to start that with Hyundai and Maruti in the year 2002. You know, the time insured every Maruti in the road. We created new networks. We ensured that the claims get settled at dealership points. We started a lot of new things, which is not there earlier. And that is where, you know, this changes happen. That's when you ask this question, I smiled. It was very close to my heart. As a good salesperson, and some of you are in sales, remember this, I've gone to sales as Bajaj Alliance, you know, let's say head. And sometimes I realize that the company, what they're asking for, the X company has something which actually is very good for them. I've told the customer, please take it from that company. It's better than what you, and this will suit your requirement. The customer asked me, okay, Tapan, you are such a senior guy. Why did you tell me this? I said, I felt after listening to you, this is what would be good for you. So, but as a company, we are inventing stuff which is good for you too. And in all probability, I've seen 95% time, the customer still comes with me. I think it's a fallacy that salespeople think that, no, you have to lie or try to be in the gray area to push your sales. I've not been trained to be a salesperson, but I've become a salesperson by experience. In my experience, telling the truth, being upfront about it has always paid for me. So we have quite a few advisors who do that. Some do not, which is a fact, and actually they would do that. So whenever an advisor is sending something, take a step back. That's my advice. Look into what he's offering, and the next day pay him the check. You'll actually have a better deal than what you would do immediately pay the check. I think that's the only word of advice I can give you, Lakshmi. But very good question. I love it. I have a long time on that question.
Sure. Thanks, Tapan.
Thank you, Lakshmi. Thank you, Lakshmi. So the next question is from Shitendra. And so the topic of today's session is leadership in uncertain times, and we are in a VUCA world. And then most of us are leaders in their own area of work. And so related to that, there's an interesting question which has come in. The question is, if you had to hire someone to replace you, what you would be looking for?
Okay. How many of you heard Elon Musk answer on an MBA in US?
Yeah,
that was a hot topic in our group. But towards the end of the article, it also said that, you know, Jeff Bezos also made the same comment, and he has the maximum number of MBAs. So we are waiting for Elon Musk to hire all of us.
But again, why is it so? See, always ask this question to yourself. No, I think then you get the answer. So let me try and explain from my perspective both things, how do I look at this, and the person I look for myself. Just a second. No? I think the debate is not on MBA. No, the debate is not about the degree that you have. Every degree to me brings a thinking module. No, let's say I say I'm a scientist by education. So if you talk to me, most time I'll be finding a problem statement and trying to solve it with experiments. No, because that is the way my education has ingrained my thinking. No, an MBA education would ingrain your thinking in a different way, and an attitude would be very different. When you look at entrepreneurs, No, for them, they are looking at a thinking style which is very different from the normal what is existing, the legacy companies or legacy procedures. No, the legacy company and legacy procedures are run by people who have an MBA degree. To counter the thought, they want people with a different thinking process, which will have a different education mechanism. As they get bigger, then again the MBA thinking gets them to the next limelight. So it is very obvious in an entrepreneur mode. Most of them actually would make a statement, be it Jeff, be it Elon Musk, be it anybody. As their company gets more matured and gets away from the entrepreneurship mode, there would be more MBAs running. Well, each brings something to the table. But an MBA who is willing to dirty his hands on the field and is a thinking mechanism of problem solving, and is a human people, to me is the best combination. Now, this is where the problem comes in. And this is where the elitist thing comes in, be it the caste system of India, be it the racialism which is there, or be it education institutions. When we create an elitist environment in which superiority starts coming into our thinking just because we belong to an elitist organization, and we move away from the crowd, and we don't dirty our hands, and we don't become a people's person, be in the crowd, and we don't become a problem solver at the highest level, then we lose the beauty of getting an MBA degree, which is there. To my mind, this is where the combination comes in. So it's not about an MBA, non-MBA. I think that is why the end says, no, Jeff has the maximum MBA now, because obviously Jeff his companies have become very big. From the time when he was a smaller company, but then he wanted a different thinking module to be an entrepreneur. So while you do MBA from a very prestigious institution, ISB, and most of you joined it, it's a phenomenal institution. I think as Bajaj, we have been one of the founding members of the institution. It's a phenomenal institution. And that will give you an elitist tag. Your humbleness to be on the ground, your humbleness to be there at all times, to be problem solver, which you have built over time. You don't lose that, you would be a very high-end leader. And why me? Everybody would be dying to have a leader like you in the team. So remember this this statement of mine: never lose your humbleness. Degrees help you think differently. A very institution puts a lot of brilliant minds together, so you have a beautiful opportunity, all of you together, such brilliant minds together. Very rarely get a chance. That is the beauty of a good institution. Now, good institution gets brilliant minds together. Bundle that with humbleness. Don't get carried by eliteness, problem solving. Be able to go to the root level, dirty your hands, and not only me, you can replace anybody in any business across the world. I think that is where this conflict is. So while Elon Musk speaks about MBA, and then you hear this last thing about Jeff, you should always think, why is it so? The guy spoke, and then why did it go? This is where the gap comes in. It's a thinking module that gets built in. And when you're going to be away from the crowd, you want a different thinking module. I think that's the only answer. So this is just, from my thinking, would be my expectation when I'm hiring people. I want to see a good MBA, a person who's been on the ground, a humble person, a thinking person, a people's person. And obviously, integrity and all has to be there. You heard about Warren Buffett's statement, if integrity is not there, anything else has no relevance. So once you put this together, I think you are ready to replace anybody, whomever you want to. Why me? Anybody.
Thank you. I think that has also answered a similar question which Abhinav had. That post the pandemic, so what do you look for in future MBA? So I think you have already talked about it. So I'll pick the next.
It's a degree which puts in a thinking, different thinking mode on business. So always remember like that. Don't think the degree is to get you better jobs, better salary, better cars. Once you start thinking on those lines, then you're confident. That will get you there. If you're a good problem solver, you're making a difference, you're making good money for shareholders, you will get money, cars, all that. That's the easier part of it. But once you are in the right thinking mode, that is all where the difference comes in. On the post-pandemic also, if you look at it, the point which I would again want is that every crisis creates new businesses, and good businesses transform themselves. The ones who don't die. Simple, no? So these are trigger points. So let's say if before pandemic happened, what were the hottest picks? Now, obviously, Airbnb again has become hot pick. It has got amazing valuation when it listed. But Uber, Ola. Now, Ola, I'm seeing that their vehicle is not on the road at all. Airbnb. And when COVID happened, suddenly, all these just completely disappeared. All the co-sharing talk that was happening of all the startups. Every startup was talking of co-sharing. that suddenly disappeared. And a new model started evolving. So in a crisis, every time existing businesses, what they had been doing very well would get hit. And that is why in crisis situations, the leader I want is one who is not, how would I say, you have leaders who are in a crisis freeze. So very beautiful leaders I have, very intellectual, but they're not seen crisis in their life. So when a crisis comes, I've seen quite a few of them freeze. And I've seen street fighters, when crisis comes, they are the ones who actually are able to lead the company to the next level, So do you have the street fighting ability? Do you have the ability when a crisis comes when people are freezing, in terms of how do you look at revenues? How do you look at, can you figure out new opportunities? It is there. It's every time there. It never happens that there's zero opportunity. And can you have the courage and the resilience, to pull it out? So post-pandemic, that is the largest piece of attribute that I'm looking for, when I'm looking for a good leader going forward.
Thank you. So the next question is from Anurag Bhadwaj, and he asked this question related to the pet insurance. So he says that recently you have been into, gone into pet insurance, but your company. And so when we talk about pet insurance, so what do you think is the future of pet insurance in India? And the second related question is, what difference do you find in pet insurance in the Asian market compared to the Western market?
Okay, as a company, we have been among the forerunners for a lot of things. Let me tell you one, and I'll come to the pet insurance, because that is more relevant to you right now, along with pet. When I was thinking earlier that when I started working, I don't know if you have seen that era, the biggest risk for me was pickpocketing as an individual. Why? Because money I had to get from a bank. So if I knew the bank cashier, I was damn lucky, So my money would get transferred to my account. I had to go to a bank, stand in a queue, take my salary, go home. I could not do that every day. My job, my boss would fire me. It's not like today's time you go to ATM and take out some amount of money. So you would take out a substantial amount of money, which would last for at least 1 month for your home needs. And that 1-2 day, if you are a pickpocketer, it was like your harvest time. Because people are going to carry money in their wallet. They will travel by bus. They will travel by local train. So the biggest risk was pickpocketing. With all my care, twice I got pickpocketed. I've yet to meet somebody of my time when people were working who said they did not get pickpocketed. That was like the biggest risk. Today, do you get pickpocketed? You don't. Your biggest risk is phishing, malware, your frauds which happen, cyber stalking. So I said, we are still not having a cover for individual level cyber. So way back, we designed an individual cyber cover. In fact, my daughters were the first to buy that policy. Well, you also had cyber stalking cover in that, along with malware, phishing, and all that. It was a phenomenal product that we made. The uptake is still very low, which is surprising again. But the belief was that today, if you lose money, it will be because of the cyber crime. And in today's pandemic time, which is shot up thousands of times. So we bring out product which you feel has become relevant for the country and for the people. Pet was one that. If I look at a pet typically for us covers dogs right now. If I look at how many people had dogs earlier, and if I take it by 20 years back, 25 years back, it was very low. Today, if I look at people who have dogs as a pet and treat the dog as a family member, it's very high. Suddenly, because nuclear family is coming in, I think people wanting to keep a pet and they treat the pet as a family member. And when I looked around, there was no IRDA-approved pet insurance. There was some like add-ons or something which was there, but a full-fledged single product as a pet insurance not in the market. So we did a lot of research internationally at the local level, and that is how we bought this product on. Again, very reasonably priced. I think it's, if you look at it, it is something which is very affordable. And I would say a very good product. So when we design products at times, and I said the cyber has not reached the stage where I thought it will, it does not mean I get discouraged. What is relevant for the market and the individual and the way society is moving, products have to design. Put it on as a thinking company. It has its time. At some time, inflection point comes and takes off. Like health insurance got designed in the year 1986. Until the year 2007, it had a very poor performance. But 2007 to 20, it has grown phenomenally. So when you design products and you put it on, it takes time, but it picks up well. So that's why we designed the pet insurance product. It has very good features. And we studied the international market, the national market. We also had to have a price point. So if you, let's say you buy a health insurance in US, and some of you may have been US, it'll cost you about 10, 12 lakhs. In India, it cost you about 30,000, 40,000 rupees. No? Price points are very different. So you have to see what all can you know do at a price point which people can and would be willing to buy. That is how we looked at it.
Thank
so,
you.
Go on. Anurag, if I may. So Tapan, thanks a lot for the answer. It was, this was my question.
Okay.
What I also rather want to know is that, see, the mindset of pet owners in India or the pet owners in India per se are not the kind of people who we have in the Western countries. And I understand the biggest market for pet insurance probably is in the UK. That is how generally people have studied and researched and stuff like that. And see, there is a global market estimate that this has a potential to reach a CAGR of, let's say, 20% and something like that. So my point is, as compared to the awareness when it comes to owning pet and taking care of pet in Western countries versus in India, because in India, some still keep it as a status symbol, some still keep it as a family member. How many do actually care about getting a pet insured? So rolling out this sort of a product, I consider, is very good. I mean, since I'm a pet parent myself, so this is a very good product for me. But then, do you see this growing at the forecasted rate as is forecasted globally, or India still has, you know, a lot of time to catch up?
I've seen very good interest coming in this product. So when we launched it, I think the social media, everything was completely buzz with it. So people are very excited, very happy to see that. The interest level is very high. Sale is not up to the level that you mentioned. No. Will it go to that level? Yes, because it's getting expensive now. See, why did health insurance take off in the year 2006-07? No, not in 86-87. Because when I was a kid, if I had a headache, the cost of my headache was a slap from my mother. No, but still. Today, when a kid has a headache, it costs 70,000 rupees. It's an MRI scan. Yeah? So fundamentally, the cost of healthcare moved up to a level where health insurance had to be purchased. It became very expensive to have, no? Otherwise, you'll not get good health care for yourself. So pet insurance, also my belief is it's getting very expensive. No? If you look at, no, when something goes wrong with a pet and you go to a vet, it's pretty expensive as a proportion. So I think as the cost starts moving up and the price point we have kept at a level, no, the sale will start happening. So those are the inflection points, Anurag. So two things I have to, as a leader, I have to keep on thinking. One is that I should have a thinking company, which I mentioned, no? We should be able to identify risks appearing before others are able to identify. Come up with solutions. And that is what gives us a brand and our name, no? That if you look at any solution, Bajaj Allianz will be the first to come out, no? As I said, if I look at, I didn't want to get into the bragging mode and talk about in the Indian insurance industry, what are solutions did you bring? But the idea is simply that any solution which has come in the market, I can probably, as I said in the beginning, 90% would have been bought by us, right from servicing or products or, no, distribution or business models, which is there. So to the point that you mentioned, now, as you rightly said, the product is very good. Price point is good, Anurag, so you studied that. Will it take off or not? I do not know. No, as an honest answer. But as it gets expensive and as more companies are coming in, I hope it will take off. No. But at least we're the first to launch a product. At least we give the framework to the industry. No, others will also know. I've already seen three companies filing for the product now with different changes, not exactly the same. And that is how market starts getting developed. So as an industry leader, it's a job to also create markets. So we're trying to create a pet insurance, and maybe after 10 years from now, it sells very well. And if we still meet somewhere, we'll talk about this conversation, no?
But no, it's a very good product, definitely. Like I said, and I think breaking into the, so there is a concept which is nowadays referred, which is a humanization concept. So a pet humanization concept is something which is fairly new in India. It is, I mean, most of the people who are still in the, educated sort of a bracket and have a pet or don't have a pet, still don't know what is a pet humanization concept. So I think it's a bold step for sure. And all the best to you. And I'm just about to be.
Buy it, Anurag. Be my customer. No.
I am just about to do that. Thank you so much.
Thank you. No, thank
yeah,
you.
That is what I was. That is what I was about to say. So you got your customer here.
That's Anurag. I told you, insurance we talk, we sell. It's a conversational sale. I told you.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Anurag.
So the next question, I've tried to club two questions, one from Naren and one from Nikhil. So the question is, in India, we still don't have many people who are taking insurance compared to the Western world. So what are your views on that? Like, what are insurers in India doing for that? And the second is are you looking forward to offering some services like subscription based model or pay as you go, or offer more online insurance?
Very good question, Anurag. So let me answer two, three things. First and foremost, you'll be surprised to know in India, 100 crore Indians are covered by insurance. I think data that you look at is GDP ratios to premium. That is how penetration looked into, which is the wrong way to look at. Just one scheme by the government, national scheme, covered 40 crore Indians, at one shot. So if you start looking at number of lives that is covered, I think India has a phenomenal insurance penetration. But yes, it is government and intervention which is there. But government intervention is there everywhere. In India, let's say if I look at private cars, the penetration of insurance in private, 90%. Indonesia did not have mandatory TP cover, like India has. Penetration of private car was 10% there. So a lot of places, if you look at US, home insurance is 95%. Why? Because you have to have a cover for cyclones, flood, and storm. What I'm trying to push in India through the government again. In India, the same person in US who has a home insurance when he comes to India, and he'll get a home insurance 1/20th the cost, does not have a home insurance. I asked this question to a lot of my friends who came from US. Hey, why are you home insurance? Tha kya? Haan, tha na yaar. Bole, yahan kyun nahi hai? Bole, socha hi nahi. So I think a lot of times, a lot of insurance get purchased because of government intervention. In India, you have an automobile insurance simply because it's mandatory to have an automobile insurance in India. That's what it's to cover. If you hata denge, 70, like in Indonesia, 90% didn't have that cover. That's why I always say it is a government and an insurance company collaboration which changes the life of India. We still you require that push, which is for the good. Now, have you ever realized that the motor third party, what all does it do? If there's no cover for motor third party, and if any one of you is uninsured, I think let me tell you one example in Gujarat. A two-wheeler, most of us don't insure. 75% two-wheelers are uninsured on the road. Why? What do we think? Arey, kitna hai yaar? 50,000 ki gaadi hai. Kuch hoga. 2,500 ban jaye. Kaun hassle karega insurance companies ye lena hai? But in Gujarat, I have a 15 crore claim on a two-wheeler, which is like a 35,000 rupees two-wheeler. A 15 crore claim on the owner of two-wheeler. Third party loss in India is unlimited and no time to file the case. So that two-wheeler hit a techie and he died. The family of techie lost a claim on the two-wheeler, which is allowed. And that is what the third party insurance is about. And the claim is 15 crore rupees. Now imagine your two-wheeler is uninsured. You have to pay the 15 crores as by law. For what, 900 rupees a year premium? So please don't be uninsured. It is very, very, it's very tricky. We're not aware about what can go wrong, no? This is where the problem comes in. I think we always think, kya hona, mujhe nahi hoga. That is, again, that's human brain wiring. My first gift, I'll tell you this small story. My father was in the services. So in my time, people, if the kid is really intelligent, he would be an engineer, a doctor, and an IAS, I think. But that was all. If you're not in this league, you are a good for nothing kind of boy. So I was not an engineer, not a doctor. I wanted to be a scientist. I didn't study for engineering or to become a doctor. Because I wanted to get the Nobel Prize for the country. The story is again something different. I grew up in Calcutta with my father and I used to go for a walk. And Jadavpur University was where C.V. Raman used to work there. And the C.V. Raman got the Nobel Prize for the country. So I heard the story from my father. So I was very, very keen that one day I'll get the Nobel Prize. So I want to be a scientist. I was very, very keen to be a scientist. So I told my parents, I don't want to do an engineering or medicine. I want to be a scientist. So my father said, okay, fair enough, study to become a scientist. And then I joined the insurance industry. My mother was really devastated. She said, if this is what you do, you let us down completely. Now, if you, sorry, I missed that question.
Yeah, so I think the related question was that we talked about the penetration of insurance companies in India.
Yeah.
What new are you offering? Like, are you offering something like that pay-as-you-go or subscription?
Yeah. So coming from that point of insurance industry where people didn't want to go to the point that I reached where people want to be here, a lot of things have changed. And this is where the mind of insurance penetration remains low. It was not seen. That's when I addressed, I said, we have to change the perception. And the work is, how do we make the claim process easy, which I mentioned in the talk, which was there. Pay as you go, you'll be happy to know we were among the pioneers who launched it on the sandbox. The idea allowed sandbox environment to put that. it got sold like hotcake, you know, when you launched. And actually, we launched it in the pandemic time because that is the time people's vehicles were all laid up. The IID approval was for X amount of sale. After the sandbox is over, you have to file a regular product. And we actually were the first company to qualify for a complete sandbox experiment to come out with flying colors. In fact, IID called us to make a presentation. That's how it happened. It happened not because we were a great company. It happened simply because pandemic happened. People's vehicle laid up. So they actually were looking for no pay-as-you-go kind of product. And we had that because sandbox that we had filed it. And if you file the product now, I think we're waiting for IID approval. Once it comes through, you'll have a pay-as-you-go product. So a lot of innovations, as I said, we keep on doing. No? It is something which is in our DNA, and we don't miss that. The issue would come in penetration would be simply because of two reasons or three reasons. One is government is the biggest reason. The more government brings into ambit the insurance, which is a good social welfare, it is going to increase. Second is individual expenses. Health penetration moved up because healthcare became expensive. So, no. And third is nuclear families. Earlier, you're a joint family. So, if something happened to somebody, the family would take care. And nuclear family, the risk becomes too high for you. Now, this is where the penetration moves up. Now, let me again connect my story. I was telling my parents, it just something came to mind and missed that. But when I joined the insurance industry, I gave my parents three policies from my side. Now, I felt it was good. One was a health insurance, other was a home insurance, and third was a personal accident cover. You buy a gift for your parents from your first salary, you know? So I did that. And my father at that time was a senior police officer. And I had a dinner conversation, let me tell you that, and then tell you what happened later. So when I gave this policy, my father looked at me and said, when he's angry, he calls me Mr. Singhal. He said, Mr. Singhal, let us understand what you have just gifted to us. I'm a government officer, so your health policy has no relevance for me. No? If I fall ill, the government takes care and they put me in the best hospital. I'm a senior police officer and your home insurance, it covers burglary, which is funny. Like you laugh at, no, if a senior police officer has a burglary insurance cover, which is there. And PM, love, I'm really one way disappointed with your choice of career and then your gift choice. I said, no, it's okay, fine. I kept on paying the renewal premium and my dad retired and after retirement, he had a bypass. After retirement, whatever position you have in the government, no, it doesn't work the way it does when you're in power and after retirement. The health policy had actually triggered and paid that claim. He was traveling to Lyon, France. He was the head for Interpol then. His house actually got burgled because no, that was after retirement. And the home policy paid for that thing. So one dinner later on, I didn't remind him of our first conversation when I joined. So insurance is critical. I think the more awareness happens, the more people take it and have faith in that. I think that is where it pays off. It will take off with the purchasing power increasing. As nuclear families happening, things getting expensive. Insurance, I think for the next 20, 30 years, I see a double-digit CAGR for the industry. So it will be one of the sunrise industries which will keep on growing at a very aggressive pace. That's my belief. Yes, Anurag.
Okay, so I'll do a time check. So we are at 5:05.
Last question, Anurag, whichever you like to ask.
Yeah, in fact, I've got 15 more questions left, and that is how much people want to talk to you or ask you. But okay,
no, I'll compliment you, Anurag. I'm charging money after. That's what Samir told you. 1 hour we don't pay you, and then we pay you for every question.
Okay, so I'll take that last question, and sorry, everybody else, I'll not be able to ask your question. So there's another interesting question by Webhav. So he has asked, so in pandemic, we have people losing the jobs or getting the pay cuts. So he has talked about this job insurance. So he says that why it is not a standalone insurance product in India? Why it is more like an add-on thing?
Very good. I love this. I think you have a brilliant set of people here. Hats off to all of you. All your questions are super questions. I loved each of it. Let me answer this pandemic in a bigger platform. I'll come to the individual thing, which is much, much more easier. And since you have researched, you know that job loss is available in loan things. Like if you take an automobile, you take a loan. We give you 3 months EMI cover for job losses. That was there. And for home also, we got it. Individual cover will also come. But that is a smaller part of the problem we're solving. So let me tell you one problem I'm solving. And when it happens, I'll be very happy. It's nearly very close to happening. And I've been instrumental in pushing this. So when pandemic happened, I'm also the CIA chairperson for insurance and pensions. So I hold many other positions other than being MD and CEO of the company, which helps me formulate government policies and regulations. I'm also the advisor chairman of IRDA. So all that helps me make a lot of the stuff. So when pandemic happened, let us understand what went wrong for coronavirus spread, because India had a lockdown which was massive, phenomenal lockdown. But what we forgot was the migrant labor issues. And if some of you remember that time, suddenly all of them out of job. Forget about other job losses, 2 months, 3 months, that is the easier problem to solve. migrant laborers had to go back. Lockdown was intense. People, they lost their jobs like immediate, no, because that was the first cut which happens and they had to move. Their movement made the spread of virus across the country also. One of the reasons, no, with other reasons she's there. Now let us say pandemic is the only one. After 1919, it has come now. Will it not happen again for the next 100 years? So are we through with the problem? Answer is no. Pandemic, as per me, is going to happen every 10 years. That 1900 years over. It is building up. Actually, we saw SARS happen. We saw Ebola happen. The only difference pandemic is because of non-symptoms, it spreads. So the curbing is difficult. No, otherwise swine flu is also very dangerous, but you had symptoms, so it was easy to curb, you know. And this is building up. Look at floods. Earlier, if you remember, the child once in 10, 20 years, now in 1 year, 5, 7. So pandemic, whatever research shows, is going to happen, which means this problem of migrant labor is going to happen again. So my suggestion, and which I said to the government and to the regulator, was that we should create a pandemic pool. They said pandemic pool cannot pay the losses. It's trillions of dollars and the insurance companies don't have that capital and the government is not going to pay for all this stuff. How do you take care of this? I said, no, we don't want to cover the pandemic losses. All I want to cover is standing charges for the industry. Standing charges means your expenses for running the plant, no, is the standing charges. So what difference will it make? I said, the difference it will make is the moment you have a lockdown, people's salary will still be paid. So you don't have the issue of job losses, you don't have the issue of migrant laborers, you don't have the issue of sudden massive movement of people across the country, and you can't control the pandemic, no, at that kind of level. So we should not repeat this again. I think that allowed my idea. I already set up a committee. If you look at the draft regulation, it has this concept of standing charges to be created. So create a pool, because when you talk about individual insurances, some of you may buy, may not buy. But if I'm able to pull this off, the next pandemic happens, job loss, because this will not happen. And that day, no. So that's why I say that as insurance, it makes a difference to society and the country at a huge level. So it's very, very close to that. Now coming to individual policies, even individual policies cover you 3 months, 4 months EMI, no. The problem with us is in our wiring is we want to buy a fire insurance when the house is on fire. It's too late. No, it's too late. Always be well covered. No, it doesn't cost you much. If whatever handsome salaries that you guys are getting paid will get paid, just 1% of 2% of that, take care of insurance, you'll be very well covered. It is very negligible. Cover yourself well, because no. So product would be there, it's not difficult. EMI product cover would be coming through. You know, the moment the pandemic is down, vaccination will come. But how many of you will buy them? Product is not a problem. So I'm trying to solve a bigger issue. Can we cover standing charges so that people don't lose lose their jobs? Okay, I'm already for my next call. It's already getting late now. So that was my last answer, no, Anurag. So thank you. Thank you very much for this opportunity and time. No, if anybody has to say something else, other 2-3 minutes, about 5-10
minutes. So Samir, over to you.
Yes. Tavan sir, if you don't mind, if you can just spare a minute and answer one question. You run this beautiful series called Street MBA. Can you just throw some light on that?
Okay. So one, as I told you, my job as an insurance professional, the way I contribute to the country, you know, and coming out, some idea I give you, the hundreds of things I do in that place, because that's what I'm obsessed about. That's why when Allianz offered me to head Asia, I didn't go there. Or when I get a global head position, I don't go there, because for me, that is immaterial. No, now my issue is how do I make a difference to my country in the profession that I'm in. So also I keep on solving statements which is different. So I suddenly realized that, no, this question used to be asked to me many times, that where have you done your MBA from? I'm not an MBA, so I would actually say I'm not an MBA. And then they would say, you're an MBA, how come you're MD? You know, I'm MD now for close to 9 years now of a company which we founded as a founding employee. You know? And then I would say, but what is the link of an MBA with an MD? You know? Anybody can be an MD if somebody is able to deliver results, you know, has a purpose, is clarity of thought. Every degree contributes to your learning. And then I started seeing the clear bias that we had, you know, in the thought process which is there. And that also was bringing down a lot of youngsters who could not afford an MBA. You know, I think all of us are very lucky. We either have a good amount of money or we come from good families. We can afford good education. But in India, most people can't afford good education. An MBA costs 7 to 10 lakh rupees. And you see the kind of loans which people take for a degree, you know, which is there just because of the obsession. If I don't get an MBA degree, I'll not get a good job. that is somehow it has got inculcated down the line. So I said, why should learning be linked to a degree? Why can't learning be everywhere? And then in one of my interviews, when again I was asked the question, where did you do an MBA from? I said, I did my MBA from the Street University. So they asked, where is the Street University? I said, no, it's every town, city, corner. And that is the day I had the idea of doing the Street MBA series. So I actually would pick up anybody, any vendor on the street and give my phone to somebody and say, shoot, and ask them questions and take out the learnings. And such phenomenal learnings from the vendors I have. So if anyone, if you have a chance and you follow me on LinkedIn, you'll see some of that. After lockdown happened, then I could not go and talk to people like that. Then I started something called Tea and Tales. Again, that's interesting because in college, I was not like the padhaku kind of guy that you are. Dinbar Sunday go better lecture soon. I would never do this. So I would actually sit on the pulley, have a cup of tea, and have great fun with my friends. And most of my learning happened, from my peer group and the pulley with a cup of tea. So I started a series now called Tea and Tales, in which a lot of interesting people come through and we have this video conversation, and that gets recorded and that also become a big hit. So each of it has a thinking behind it, Samir, something I'm trying to solve in my own way, give some learnings from remotest corner and very, and it doesn't take much time. So not fancy, I don't have a big cameraman or something, just a phone, give it to somebody, and the phones are very good today. Let them record, have a conversation, put it on. I think as simple as that. So do it, all of you, you should do it. Because you also learn so much, you meet so many people, interesting people to learn so much. Why do you want to keep the learning to yourself? Why do you share your learning to everybody else? No, that's the philosophy. So whatever you learn, put it. People may read, not read, it's fine, but you've done your duty of sharing your learning with the world. So keep on doing that. And that is how Samir this started.
Thank you so much for accepting my request and joining at such a short notice, Prabhupada. Your story and the values have definitely inspired quite a few of us. And I'm sure we will implement quite a few of these things in our life as well. Thank you so much for joining us.
Samir, I cannot say no to you. Why you're one of my first employees at the age of 19. I never forget. Such a brilliant young guy. Yeah? So when you call up, how can I say no? I said, okay. But thank you. I think all of you have been a lovely audience. I had a great time talking to all of you. If I can be of any help to any one of you, don't hesitate to reach out to me. I love brilliant young minds the way all of you are. And please keep up the good job. And on a Sunday, don't attend lectures. And some of you never agree for a Sunday. Know that you agree for me. Please, you're spoiling every Sunday. So have a great time, guys. Thank you very much. Bye.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much, sir. Thank you.
We can watch for that. Thank you.